something about when family come together.
Amen.
The family of God comes together.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
To break the bread of life together. He said, whosoever will, let them come. So at this time, I extend that welcome to this feast of God's Holy Spirit, His anointing, and His glory. As the praise team comes, oh, wait a minute. I can go a little bit longer. Because there is so much good to say about our God.
Yeah.
The Bible said, in the beginning, God created the world, the universe. And God spoke everything into existence. And then He made man and woman to worship and praise Him. That reason we are here today. So whatever the situation may be in your life, give it to God. He says, cast all your cares upon Him. Cast them all, because He cares for all of us. In this life, with the heat, it ain't one thing, it's a hurricane the next, rain, cold. You know, things seem to be getting confusing, getting difficult. But guess what? God is still in control. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's give a shout of hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
To our God.
Yeah.
As the praise team comes.
Amen.
Good morning, St. John. Anybody glad to be in the house of God one more time? Let's just clap our hands again. It's good to be in the house of God one more time. We have another chance to say thank you. We have another chance to lift His name. We have another chance to tell Him how much we love and appreciate Him. Amen. So won't you bless the Lord with us? Come on, let's just clap our hands right where you are.
Thank you.
Thank you. life and honor you. Thank you.
Hey, give the Lord praise.
Amen.
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 Amen. Praise be praised.
Amen.
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 I mean, the table is set. I mean, you're getting all the love, all the joy, all the praise. Amen.
Amen.
To God. Because when the praises go up, the blessings come down.
Amen.
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 Try sometimes. It seems like your back is up against the wall. Just call on the Lord. When you draw close to God, He's going to draw close to you. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Amen. I give myself away, Lord, so I can praise Thee in the midst of the storms. Like, our scripture reading this morning comes from the 17th number of Psalms, stanzas 1 through 7. It says, hear the right, O Lord. Attend unto my cry. Give ear unto my prayer. That goeth not out of feast lips. Let my sinners come forth from thy presence. Let thine eyes behold the things that are equal. Thou hast proved my heart. Thou hast visited me in the night. Thou hast turned me, and shall find nothing. I am purposed that my mouth shall not transgress. Concerning the works of men, by the word of thy lips, I have kept me from the path of the destroyer. Hold up my going in the path, that my footsteps slip not. I have called upon thee, but thou wilt hear me. O God, incline thine ear unto me, and hear my speech. Show thy marvelous loving kindness. O thou that savest by the right hand, them which put their trust in thee from those that rise up against them. Keep me as the apple of the eye. Hide me under the shadow of thy wings. From the wicked that oppresses me, from my deadly enemies, who compasses me about. They are enclosed in their own fat. With their mouth they speak proudly. They have not compassed us in our steps. They have set their eyes bowing down to the earth. Like a lion, they is greedy of his prey. And as it were a young lion lurking in secret places. Arise, O Lord. Disappoint him, cast him down. Deliver my soul from the wicked, which is thy soul. From men which are thy hand. O Lord, from men of the world, which have their portion in this life, and whose belly thou fillest with thy hid treasure. They are full of children and leave the rest of their substance to their babes. As for me, I will behold thy face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake with the likeness. The word of God to the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us bow. Holy Father, once again we enter into this sanctuary and to your house, God. We come to worship and to praise you, O God, God, through song, through scripture, through love of you, Father. We come in the mighty name of Jesus, O God, to lift you up, O God, in our hearts As we travel through this world, God, we know that you are there with us. Oh God, you wake us up this morning, starting us on our way. So we say thank you, God. Thank you for all the many blessings you have given us, oh God. When we look back where we come from and where we is now, we know that there's nobody but you, God, that has brought us here. So we come to praise you today, God. Bless the pastor, bless this sanctuary, bless your holy people today who love you so much, God. Bless us, send your anointing, fill this place, let it bow down and break every yoke that's trying to come against your children. In Jesus' holy name I pray, amen.
The reading comes today from Matthew chapter 14, verse 13 through 21. When Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by a boat privately to a solitary place. Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed their sick. As the evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place, and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the villages and buy themselves some food." And Jesus replied, "They do not need to go away. You give them something to eat." "We have here only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish," they answered. "Bring them here to me," he said. And they directed the people to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate and were satisfied, and the disciples picked up 12 baskets full of broken pieces that were left over. The number of those who ate was about 5,000 men, besides women and children.
Amen.
Yesterday was our thrift hunt day, and I thank Cheryl and Jessa. That's what I call her. I know it's Jessenia, but I call her Jessa. She was such a great help yesterday, and it's a blessing to see her growth from where she was and what she is right now, and how Trey has blossomed. He's always been a person of, he was always enthused about the Word of God and how he comes to read, and that's a blessing. You know, for our young people and how we miss our others that are gone to college. But yesterday it was real, it was slow. And you know, God really blessed, you know, he blessed us. And we were able to raise $220 for the thrift hunt yesterday. That was a blessing, a blessing, truly a blessing. And so, you know, during the time we're in the Thrift Hut, sometimes, you know, we don't never know who we're going to meet or who we're going to see. And this, you know, God always bring things to fruition. You know, he has a way of just bringing things to full circle. So this journey started when Pastor John was here, what, 4 years ago now? Is it four? It's quite 4 years. I think it's, But anyway, it started with him, and a guy across the street came over and asked him about some questions, whatever he wanted, blah, 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 blah. From then, it went to Pastor Kagoro. Did not know he was sitting on the porch when we had drive-up service, listening to the service. So when people would call him, he said, "Don't call me, I'm in church." And I said, "Where are you at?" He said, "I'm in church. I can't talk to you right now." That's what he told Pastor Jeffrey. So one Sunday after service, he came over, not knowing to us, and brought a picture that he had drawn on the front of the church. So yesterday, this lady came in, and the lady came in, and we said, "How you doing?" Whatever. She said, "My sister said to come over here because y'all have really good things." And I said, "Yes." And so anyway, so I looked at her, I said, "I know her." She did the same thing. She said, "But I know you too." You know, just like that. So we got the, you know, talking. She kept coming back and forth. And then the spirit just said, "Walmart." I mean, just as clear as day. And I say, "You still at Walmart?" She said, "Girl, no, I knew you," just like that. She said, "I live across the street." I said, "Well, you know, it was a man that lived across the street that drew us a picture one time." I said, "So they must have moved." She said, "No, that's my husband." I said, "What?" I say, "What?" She said, "Yes. He's not doing well, but he looked good this morning." So anyway, we got to talking, we exchanged phone numbers, and you know, it just show you how God moves, not in our time, but in his time. So I told him, I said, you know, come over to community breakfast. You know, we have that on the first Sunday, me and cook, blah, blah, blah. So she said, "I'll tell you what, I'll go and get it and bring it to you." And I did this morning, not putting no light to myself. But it's just like the song say, I give myself away to God for things that I do. It's not my doing, because I would sit there and be selfish and don't want to do nothing. Mm-hmm. But it's God. Yeah. It's the God in us that we do things. Amen. It's the God in you that you do things. Amen. No matter what your friends say, no matter what your family say, keep doing for God. Amen. Keep doing for him. Mm-hmm. So when I drove up in the driveway, she said, "Get out of the car." She said, "Ben wants to meet you." I said, "What?" So I had to go in. He was so excited to meet me as I was so excited to meet him. And just to think about it, so when I tell Pastor John, I have a story to tell him. You know, it is, God is so good. He is so good. So they're gonna try to come over. And I told him, if he can't make it over, you know, let us know. And we'll be glad to come visit them, bring them communion or whatever. And we have a Wednesday service they come to. So, you know, God is so good. Thomas was admitted to the hospital this week. He's diagnosed with congestive heart failure. He was all out of sort and everything. So anyway, I told the common down here that I had to talk to him. So he's out. They let him out last night. So he is at home, back at home now. And he's doing good. So we just thank God for all the things that he's doing for us and others.
Thank you. You're good. Miss Jane, did you have your hand up? Okay.
Yes, God have blessed you all. Everybody can be here and you may have brought up before. All right, thank y'all.
Amen. Okay. Anybody else? Yes, Ms. Jane.
My granddaughter posted on Facebook that my great-granddaughter will be arriving sooner than expected. The doctors are, everything's all right with Victoria and Allergy, but because of massive incision that she had for her previous surgery, the doctor wants to take the baby even earlier than we expected. So I will have my great-granddaughter sometime in September rather than in October.
I'm so excited. Anybody else? Yes, go ahead, Jerry.
Good morning, everyone. So we took Malik to Hezekiah back to his parents last Sunday, and brought him home, and he'll be back Monday here for their get-together to do their wedding again. So my son, Malachi, we dropped him off at college on Thursday, and most of the day they got there, they had him on the tarmac where they do all of their wheels.
Yeah.
As hot as it was. They were there, they're out there. They made sure that they carried the water with them at all times. So. But he said he's enjoying it, and I'm glad of that. And in the meantime, getting them out of the house and everything, then I found out I broke my left foot and about 2 or 3 different places. I've never had broken bones until about.
That's frustrating.
It is.
We're praying for you, Terry, with that. Any other prayer requests? Ms. Jenny.
Right for anybody that's sick. Vanilla Ellis, one, had children and one, the last girl, pray about it.
Okay. Yes, Kathy.
I have a prayer request. My oldest daughter, Randy Russ, lost her father about a week and a half ago. And just like everybody said, we'll pray for her. She's having a hard time.
Yes, go ahead, Jack.
Good morning. I just want to pray that my son Marcus, he needs some reliable caretakers. The military is paying these people. They come for a day or two with me. Nobody was for it. So, I mean, the military pays them very well, but and he has to have a four-year. If you don't have to pick him up, there's no heavy burden involved. It's just that you have to, he's moved up and well, he has to have baths and showers and stuff. He has a big shower to go into a shower chair. But then people come and quit. I don't understand. And my husband's in New Jersey. I just have to go to work now that especially tomorrow kids come back. But I feel bad when I have to leave him. And one lady left him in a shower chair. We had to report her.
I got you covered.
Okay.
I got 3 people there if you want to bring them.
Okay.
Thank you. What a
blessing.
Children, oh, go ahead. Did you have some more, Jack? You were done, or yet? Okay. I'm going to invite all of our children, and are they all young adults, to come forward and let's pray for them as they start school this week. And Ray, if you want to join us, you're the only. I tried to catch all our college kids before they left, but we're going to let you take the blessing for all of them, okay? And for Malachi from a distance, okay? Terry, if you want to come forward, or we'll just pray for Malachi, okay? And all our others, y'all just stand up here and just tell everybody, if y'all don't mind, just what grade you're going into or where you're going to college, and just remind everybody, just so that you get started.
I'm going into
9th
grade.
You're in high school, okay, Faith, okay.
I'm 11.
At the Faith Academy too, and Ray is starting college.
Oh, yeah.
Woo-hoo, yes.
Well, I want to thank y'all too. It's my last time here with y'all. Yeah.
Oh, yes.
I'll leave this week, and I ask you.
Okay. All right. Well, let's just say a special prayer for them and a prayer in general. So let's bow our head to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we just thank you for this time together, for the opportunity to come and worship you, Lord. And we just come here today praying for all of those that are sick and all the needs that have been mentioned. And Lord, we pray a special prayer and a special blessing on these wonderful young people that have been a part of St. John and continue to be, Lord. We pray for them as they go into start a new journey, right? As they start a new journey, whether it be a new year in high school or starting and moving to another place. Lord, we pray for Ray and Malachi, and we pray for all of those that are starting their college years, Lord. And Davon as well, yes, as they start in college this year. We ask a special blessing on them to just be with them, to walk with them, to give them a peace that passes all understanding when they take one of those classes and they look at the syllabus and say, oh my goodness, Lord. So we just pray a special prayer for them as in their academics and in their social life and every other way, Lord. And we ask it in your blessed and holy name, in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we all say, amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Thank you all. Sorry that I didn't forewarn y'all about that. I thought y'all might not show up today if I did. But thank you. We're very excited about y'all and your new journey as you prepare and get ready for that. So as a result of Jesus' ministry, large crowds follow him, right? We see this repeatedly. And in Matthew 14:13, Jesus once again leads a crowd just briefly, and he takes refuge on a boat. But once again, the crowd follows him, right? And one of Jesus' most recognized miracles is found in the text that we read about today. But it occurs only after Jesus spends time healing the sick. See, after seeing the crowd, Jesus felt compassion upon them. We often emphasize the miracle, but we kind of overlook the sympathy that literally moves Jesus to start taking care of people that day, right? Jesus' compassion compels him to act. So too should it be with each of us. While we feel sympathy for someone who is sick or not doing well, how often does the emotion result in taking action toward them? So there's more than one lesson in our story today. Jesus cures the sick people in the crowd because he cared for them. Apparently, Jesus' healing had taken a great deal of time that day, right? Because his disciples come to him and they suggest that he sends the crowd away, right? The disciples request, it's not malicious now. They simply are aware of the location. They're in this very deserted place, and the time of day is ending. It's becoming evening. But Jesus says back to his disciples, they need not go away. You give them something to eat. They reply, well, we have nothing, right? But these five loaves and these two fish. To the disciples, there is no real logical outcome for feeding a crowd of 5,000 plus. They did not see a solution to the inadequacy of food for such a large group. Really, the truth is, the situation looked impossible. Just impossible. Now, how different are we when we find ourselves in a place of inadequacy or a situation that seems impossible? Impossible. Has this word crossed your lips lately as you peer at a unsolvable problem? The dictionary defines impossible as incapable of being done or attained or fulfilled, insuperably difficult, impossible, impassable, right? So what is your impossible circumstance right now? Maybe you're dealing with a wayward teen or an adult child who has strayed, has gone in the wrong direction. Maybe it's your marriage. Maybe you and your spouse hardly even speak to each other. Maybe it's financial. Too many bills, not enough money to cover them. Or maybe it's a physical ailment that has been declared really untreatable or chronic by a doctor. The categories of impossibilities go on and on and on, don't they? See, whatever obstacle that is impassable for you, or whatever situation is intolerable, may feel impossible. One that no counselor or friend or pastor or family member can bring a needed change to. But just maybe, inside its uncrackable shell is an incredible opportunity waiting to come to life. Because Jesus has the power to make the impossible possible. Jesus demonstrated such power in the story that we look at today and repeatedly throughout his ministry, because Jesus has the power over quantity, quality, distance, time, nature, misfortune, and even death. In today's text, the disciples approach it with a humankind, or from a humankind's angle, don't they? It's getting late. People are probably getting really hungry. But Jesus seems to be perplexed by the disciples' request to send them away. Why should they leave when the disciples have food? No, Jesus, he didn't send them away. No, instead of that, he commands them to sit down on the grass, right? He then gets working, doing what he's come to do, curing every disease and sickness among the people. The multiplication of loaves of bread and the fish hearken to our previous parable, right? That Jesus speaks to the crowd concerning the mustard seed. Remember that from last week? The kingdom of heaven produces a plentiful harvest from the smallest seed. The miracle demonstrates that Jesus attends to both the physical needs of the people in both sickness and in their physical need of hunger. He does not focus solely on the spiritual health through his teaching. He's also concerned with the sick, and he sympathizes with those who are hungry. And he goes about to meet their immediate needs, doesn't he? Today's story tells us that Jesus fed over 5,000 people with five small loaves and two sardine-sized fish. Can you imagine? How could so little feed so many? The math just doesn't add up for the disciples, right? But lack of enough never limited Jesus' ability. Because Jesus has the power over quantity, doesn't he?
Yes.
But Jesus also has the power over quality and distance and time and nature and misfortune and even death.
Yes.
In John 2, we hear about a wedding in Cana when the wine ran out, and Jesus told the servants to fill 6 stone pots with water and then to take a cupful to the head waiter. Putting that cup to his lips, the waiter tested it. And Jesus had not only turned the water to wine, but the very best wine, right? A wine that could not be matched by any other. Because Jesus has the power also over quality. Later in John 4:50, a royal official came to Canaan to ask Jesus to heal his dying son in Capernaum. It was about 20 miles away. And without even moving, Jesus told him, "Go back home. Your son will live." He healed a boy from a distance because Jesus has power over distance.
Yes.
In John 5:8, we hear about a pool in Bethsaida. Jesus saw this man there who had been disabled for some 38 long years. The Lord commanded him, "Stand up, pick your mat up, and walk." It didn't matter that the man had been lame for almost 4 decades. When Jesus said walk, guess what? He walked.
Yes.
Because Jesus has the power also over time. In Matthew 8, when a strong wind stirred up the sea and terrified the disciples, strained at the oars to make it to the shore, Jesus calmed the storm, because Jesus has the power over nature. In Jerusalem, Jesus noticed a blind man since birth. And Jesus, who was the light of the world, brought light to that man's eyes, because Jesus has power over misfortune. And in John 11:1-44, we hear that Lazarus had died.
His sister's hopes had died with him. However, Jesus transformed their impossibility into a perfect opportunity to glorify God by bringing Lazarus back to life. Because Jesus has power even over death. Our passage today shows the power of Jesus in a miracle of the loaves and fish. He has the power over quantity, but Jesus also shows the power over quality, distance, life, nature, misfortune, and even death. He has the power to do the impossible. But we have to take our impossible situation and we have to lay it at the feet of Jesus. That's what my friend Beverly Van did in an almost impossible situation. Her story took place in the late 50s. She says, when I was 8 years old, my family of five went to visit relatives in Seattle, Washington, from Louisiana. At that time, traveling that far took a long time, and it took some money, which was very scarce in her family. She said, we had saved for years to make this trip to Seattle to see her mom's family. On our way, we stopped many times for meals to sleep and many bathroom stops because of poor females. After we left one of the bathroom stops, she said, my mom asked my dad if he would give her a stamp so she could mail a letter. And he said, I will, let me get it out of my wallet. But when he reached in his pocket to get his wallet, the wallet wasn't there. Immediately, he thought back to where he had had it last. And it was a service station where they had gotten gas and then he had gone to the restroom afterwards. And he thought, oh my goodness, it must have fallen out of my pocket there while I was using the restroom at that gas station, which was miles away from them. They had passed it so long ago. At that point, Beverly said, we all realized we couldn't continue on this journey. That's all the money we had was in my dad's wallet, she said. And she said, at 8 years old, I began fervently praying, oh, please, God, help us get dad's wallet back with the money so we can complete this trip, so that we can move forward and do anything. She said she had no more poured out her heart to God when her dad saw this state trooper across the highway. So he signaled him to help him. And while he was there talking to him, he was telling the whole story to the officer. Another car pulled up. And the driver in the car got out and he came over to the officer and he said, I was at this bathroom miles back and I found this wallet here. And I really didn't know what to do. I'm going to leave it with you, officer. Her dad was standing there. It was his wallet. At that moment, Beverly said, I knew without a doubt that God did the impossible and he answered my prayer.
Amen.
Humanly speaking, Beverly's problem seemed as impossible as calculus would be to a preschooler. But to Jesus, the solution was obvious. He understood what's impossible for people is possible for God, right? He lived every day by Jeremiah's prayer. Listen to these words. Oh, sovereign Lord, you made the heaven and the earth by your strong hand and powerful arm. Nothing is too hard for you.
Amen.
Nothing is too hard for you. Well, how do we stop right now and bow our heads and think about what's going on in your life, what's impossible to you, what appears impossible? And let's pray Jeremiah's prayer for your impossibility. And finish the phrase, oh, sovereign Lord, nothing is too hard for you regarding. And just fill in that blank. Oh, sovereign Lord, nothing is too hard for you regarding my personal impossibility. And then commit to surrendering this impossibility to the Lord from this day on. We're going to leave this request with you, O sovereign God, who is both strong and powerful. Amen. See, miracles, they're surprising. They're unexplainable. They're as rare as a flawless pearl, aren't they? But they do occur. We can't predict when God will sovereignly say, now, and transform the impossibility into opportunities. But what we can do is believe in his power and rest in his sovereignty. As we prepare to go to the Lord's table today, let's pray. Eternal God, we're hungry in body and spirit. We're empty and we long to be filled. We're hungry and long to be fed. We're lost and long to be found. Heal our brokenness through the breaking of this bread and the sharing of this cup. And then pick up the pieces of our lives, just as Jesus gathered the fragments of bread and fish after feeding the 5,000. We come to you knowing you are God, the only God who transforms the impossibilities into opportunities. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus
Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Please join me in a great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is our delight and our privilege to lift our hearts to you, our Lord and God, because in this Eucharistic feast, you give us the pattern of our salvation. In the inadequacy of the loaves and fishes, we see our paltry offerings from the gift of your creation. But just as in incarnation, cross, resurrection, you took and blessed and broke and shared our human nature in Jesus. So he took and he blessed and he broke and he shared the loaves and the fishes to be our overflowing banquet of glory for your hungry people. Through the abundance of 12 baskets left over, you restore Israel's 12 tribes to service in your kingdom, and you invite us to share your feast with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven. singing the hymn of unending praise.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth for your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
Out of nothing, God of mercy, you made your creation. And out of slavery and wilderness, you called your chosen people. Out of flesh and blood and dust and ashes, you summon us to be your church. Send your Holy Spirit upon us now, that we become holy, even as you are holy. Sanctify this bread and wine, that they may transform our hearts and our minds and souls and voices as they become for us the holy, as they become for us the body and blood of your blessed Son and Lord, who at supper with his disciples took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to them, saying, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup again. He gave thanks and gave it to his disciples, saying, drink this, all of you. This is the blood of the new creation, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ is God. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
God, of all whose struggles you wrestle with Jacob until daybreak, open the eyes of all who fight all night to learn if their battle is indeed with you. Visit the hearts of any who limp because of an old wound to understand if your wound was part of your redemption. As you gave Jacob a new name, as in baptism you seal each of us with your name as adopted children, bless those who search to find their true identity or to discover who you truly want them to be. Come among all who are oppressed, that they may see you face to face. And in you find life and hope until the day when glory is fully revealed, and you are all in all, ever one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, our living God. Amen. Let us pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Servers, come forward. Invited to come to the Lord's table at this time.
Good morning, Dionysia.
Buddy out here.
Church Council will be August next Sunday, August 13th at 3 p.m.
Man eating out Monday, August 14th at Aztecs across from Providence Hospital. Noon communion will be Wednesday, October 16th at 12 noon. Allen Prayer Group will be Thursday, August 17th, 2023. The Wesley Foundation is having a luncheon, and we have a sign-up list out on the podium out in the vestibule. It is Wednesday, August 23rd. We will provide the lunch for the students of USA at the Wesley Foundation. There is a sign-up sheet, like I said. Please have food at church ready to eat in disposable containers by 10:15 that day. Thank you for your support, and have a blessed week.
Thank you, Carolyn. And just to remember as you go into your week, to know that God takes impossible situations and makes them possible. So let's take those cares and put them at His feet. And go in peace to love and serve our Lord. Amen.
Amen.